Good.
Thankful that we can worship Jesus together today. We're to the third Sunday of the season of Lent. And in the season of Lent, of course, we focus on Jesus' cross, how Jesus suffered and died for us. Today, however, as we talk about the cross, we're going to hear the Bible say something surprising about it. Today, we're going to hear how foolish Jesus' cross is. As an example, open up your worship folder to page 4. And you'll see our verse of the day is from 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 18. We're going to hear today about the foolishness of the cross. Let's read that verse together. For the message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. Today we're going to be reminded from God's word that we're saved not from our own wisdom and intelligence, but we're saved by faith in what Jesus has done for us. And may God bless us as we worship Him together. Start by singing our first song, a legend song, Glory Be to Jesus. Death because every person has sinned.
Sin entered the world through one man, and death through sin. And in this way, death came to all people because all sinned.
As thus, let us humbly confess our sins to God.
Holy and merciful Father, I confess that I am by nature sinful, and that I have disobeyed you in my thoughts, words, and actions. I have done what is evil and failed to do what is good. For this I deserve your punishment, both now and in eternity. But I am truly sorry for my sins, and trusting in my Savior Jesus Christ, I pray, Lord, have mercy on me, a sinner.
The wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. Jesus promises, I am the resurrection and the life. The one who believes in me will live, even though they die. And whoever lives by believing in me will never die. God, our Heavenly Father, has forgiven all your sins. By the perfect life and innocent death of our Lord Jesus Christ, he has removed your guilt forever. You are his own dear child. May God give you strength to live according to his will.
Amen.
Be seated. Sing a song about Jesus' cross. When I survey the wondrous cross. Sin of the parents to the third and fourth generation of those who hate me, but showing love to 1,000 generations of those who love me and keep my commandments.
You shall not misuse the name of the Lord your God, for the Lord will not hold anyone guiltless who misuses his name.
Remember the Sabbath day by keeping it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is a Sabbath to the Lord your God. On it you shall not do any work, neither you nor your son or daughter, nor your male or female servant, nor your animals, nor any foreigner residing in your towns. For in 6 days the Lord made the heavens and the earth, the sea and all that is in them, but he rested on the seventh day. Therefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and made it holy.
Honor your father and mother, so that you may live long in the land the Lord your God is giving you.
Shall not murder, shall not commit adultery, you shall not steal, you shall not give false testimony against your neighbor, You shall not covet your neighbor's house. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife, or his male or female servant, his ox or donkey, or anything that belongs to your neighbor. When the people saw the thunder and lightning and heard the trumpet and saw the mountain in smoke, they trembled with fear. They stayed at a distance and said to Moses,
"Speak to us yourself, and we will listen. But do not have God speak to us, or we will die."
Moses said to the people, "Do not be afraid. God has come to test you, so that the fear of God will be with you to keep you from sinning." This is God's word. Hopefully, as we read those Ten Commandments, they sound familiar. Right? Shake your head, yes. You've heard these before? This is God's word for us, his people. Before we move on, though, I just want to make one point. Often, when we hear people talk about the commandments, they talk as if the commandments are what makes us good. If we want people to be good, we should have the Ten Commandments more places. The Ten Commandments make people good. Is that true? No. Not at all. Who is it who makes people good? Jesus is. If we want people to be good, they need to have all of their sins away, and they need to have the Holy Spirit in their hearts. And who's the one who does that? Jesus does. Okay? In fact, the Ten Commandments for us, they really do the opposite. The Ten Commandments are good. They come from God himself. But what the Ten Commandments do is they show us our sins, and they show us how much we need a Savior. I bet as we read these, you didn't start to feel good about yourself. You thought, yeah. Ten Commandments show us our sin, and that's good, so that we can see how Jesus brings us forgiveness through his cross. Our gospel lesson today is from the Gospel of John, chapter 2. In this lesson, we see that Jesus takes God's word seriously. In this lesson, Jesus gets angry. Jesus drives people out of the temple because they were using the temple as a place to make money instead of as a place to hear God's word. You see Jesus take God's word seriously. It was almost time for the Jewish Passover. Jesus went up to Jerusalem. In the temple courts, he found people selling cattle, sheep, and doves, and others sitting at tables exchanging money. So he made a whip out of cords and drove all from the temple courts, both sheep and cattle. He scattered the coins of the money changers and overturned their tables. To those who sold doves, he said, "Get these out of here. Stop turning my father's house into a market." His disciples remembered that it is written,
"Zeal for your house will consume me."
The Jews then responded to him, "What sign can you show us to prove your authority to do this?" Jesus answered them,
"Destroy this temple, and I will raise it again in 3 days.
They replied, "It has taken 46 years to build this temple, and you are going to raise it in 3 days?" But the temple he had spoken of was his body. After he was raised from the dead, his disciples recalled what he had said. Then they believed the scripture and the words that Jesus had spoken. This is God's word. This past Wednesday, as we talked about the seven deadly sins, we talked about the sin of anger. And we said that for us human beings, it's hard for us to be angry without sinning. But we also added that anger, in and of itself, isn't always wrong. How did Jesus feel in this lesson? He was angry. He was justifiably angry at people misusing the temple for their own purposes. I want you to take note of how the Jews asked Jesus, "Give us a sign." It's going to come up in our sermon today. Can you remember that for like 10 minutes until it comes up in our sermon? All right? They ask him for a sign. And what's the sign that Jesus gives them? His death and resurrection. "You want to see why I have authority to do this? Well, just wait. I'm going to die, and in 3 days I'm going to rise again. And no one needs any more proof than that I am who I say I am and I can do what I do. I'm going to die and rise." That's the sign. So in our next song, another song about the cross, lift high the cross. And during the final refrain, the kids are invited to come up here to the front for our children's devotion. But Naomi, remember how I started the service. I said today we're going to talk about something kind of strange. We're going to talk about how it seems foolish that Jesus died on the cross. You know what foolish means? Kind of like silly or wrong, and like it shouldn't happen. It almost seems like it shouldn't have happened for Jesus to die on the cross. I want to give an example. Jesus is like our hero, right? He's the one who saves us, right? Another hero is Batman. Batman's a hero. Have you ever watched a Batman show where Batman dies? No! Because he's a hero, he never dies. Alright, how about another hero? Paw Patrol. Have you ever watched Paw Patrol? Yes? Have you ever watched the Paw Patrol episode where they all die? No, that's not real, because if they're a hero, they don't die. Right? I bet some of you... Sometimes they get caught. That's true. They just never die. Some of you, I bet, like watching shows about princesses. Do you ever watch a show about like a princess? Yeah, does the princess at the end just die? No! Why would that happen? Right? In life, it seems like people who are heroes, who are really special, they don't die. This is what's strange about Jesus. Jesus, the greatest thing that he did was die on a cross. That's different than the Paw Patrol or Batman or a princess. Jesus, the best thing he did was die. Doesn't that sound kind of strange? But there's a reason Jesus died on the cross. To save us from our sins. To take our sins away. Somebody had to die. And so Jesus died for us. And we know the rest of the story. Jesus didn't just stay dead, did he?
No,
he rose from the dead. On what really special day did Jesus rise from the dead? On Easter, Jesus rose from the dead. And I want you to know that the person you believe in Jesus, he's special. He's even more special than a superhero or the Paw Patrol or a princess, because Jesus came to die on the cross for us and to rise again to take our sins away so we could go to heaven. That's pretty cool. Yeah, that's pretty cool. All right, let's say, bow our heads and say a prayer to thank Jesus for his cross. Jesus, you're different from the other heroes that we think about. You didn't just come to win a big victory. You came to die on a cross for us. Thank you for taking all of our sins away. Thank you for rising from the dead so we can go to heaven. Help us to know that you're special because you are willing to die for us. In your name we pray. Amen. Thanks for coming up here. God bless your day. Why? Our last lesson and our lesson for our sermon today is from the New Testament, from 1 Corinthians chapter 1. Listen to the kind of surprising way that the Apostle Paul talks about Jesus' cross. For the message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise, the intelligence of the intelligent I will frustrate. Where is the wise person? Where is the teacher of the law? Where is the philosopher of this age? Has not God made foolish the wisdom of the world? For since in the wisdom of God, the world, through its wisdom, did not know him, God was pleased through the foolishness of what was preached to save those who believe. Jews demand signs, and Greeks look for wisdom. But we preach Christ crucified, a stumbling block to Jews and foolishness to Gentiles. But to those whom God has called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ, the power of God and the wisdom of God. For the foolishness of God is wiser than human wisdom, and the weakness of God is stronger than human strength. This is God's word. Friends of Jesus, Christianity is foolish. Do you ever hear people talk like that? Here's some examples. Someone once said, the word God is nothing more than the expression and product of weak men. In other words, God is just an invention of weak human beings. Do you know who said that? Albert Einstein. You say, huh? He was a pretty smart guy, wasn't he? Here's another one. The history of the Gospels is so defective and doubtful that it's vain to even inquire into it. In other words, the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, that tell us about Jesus, the Gospels, they're so doubtful and defective, so foolish, it's not even worth it to look into. You know who said that? Thomas Jefferson. And then Thomas Jefferson actually cut out of his Bible every miracle that Jesus did, including the resurrection. It's foolish. Why would he say that? Why would intelligent people think that Christianity is foolish? Maybe we should think about what Christianity teaches. The Bible teaches that every single human being is by nature sinful from the moment we're conceived. How does that sound today? Foolish. The Bible teaches that God Himself entered into the womb of the Virgin Mary and He was born as a human being. How does that sound today? Foolish. The Bible teaches that God saved the world by being executed on a cross. How does that sound? Foolish. The Bible says that after He died, Jesus raised Himself from the dead 3 days later. How does that sound today? Foolish. I mean, haven't we moved on from all that? I mean, I can see why people long ago, they needed religion, they needed gods long ago, but haven't we progressed further than that? Haven't we moved past all of these legends and myths? I mean, look at what we human beings are accomplishing. We have Wi-Fi. We have cell phones. We have self-driving cars. We even invented football. I mean, it doesn't get any better than that, does it? Sin? God? Having saved the world? Is that foolish? Do you hear people say that? But maybe even sometimes you yourself start to think that. To start today, I want you to realize that that's nothing new. The idea that we should move on from the foolishness of God is nothing new. Already 2,000 years ago, the Apostle Paul wrote, "The message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God." Already 2,000 years ago, Paul says that the message that Jesus died on the cross for the sins of the world, it was received in two very different ways. To those who were perishing, to those who didn't believe, it's foolishness. To those who were being saved, to those who did believe, it was the power of God. This is exactly how God planned it. God decided that people are not going to be saved by our wisdom. Instead, people are saved by faith in Jesus. In our lesson, Paul quotes a verse from the Old Testament, way back from the prophet Isaiah. God said, "I will destroy the wisdom of the wise, and the intelligence of the intelligent I will frustrate." God decided long ago that He was not going to save people through their wisdom. In fact, God decided that He would save the world in a way that's totally contrary to human wisdom. God was going to save the world in a way that seemed foolish, so that salvation would all be by faith. If the most intelligent people in the world think Christianity's foolish, don't be surprised. Because Christianity isn't about how intelligent you are. It's all by faith. This is still hard. I don't know about you, but I can be easily impacted by what other people say. To hear the wise people of today make fun of what the Bible teaches, it's hard, isn't it? Even makes you wonder for yourself, maybe they're right. Instead, maybe this is the question we should ask. Who really is wise? Apostle Paul says, "Where is the wise person? Where is the teacher of the law? Where is the philosopher of this age? Has not God made foolish the wisdom of the world?" We human beings, we do kind of an ironic thing. We set our own standards for what it is to be wise. And it always changes, right? It's always changing. We set our own standards for what it is to be wise, and then we call ourselves wise based on our own standards. Is that what we do? Does that work in the eyes of God? No. Has not God made foolish the wisdom of the world? Just think of some examples. Some examples of what is touted as human wisdom today. We human beings in America, we are so wise that we've decided that when there's a little body growing inside of a woman. And when that little body has a human head and human hands and a human heart, we know exactly what that little body is not. Right? What is it not? A human being. Right? We've reached this level of wisdom that this little body, it has a human head and human hands and human heart, but we are so wise that we know that it's not a human being. It's just a fetus. Right? We shouldn't even use the word baby. It's not what it is. Because we're wise. You know what God says? It's foolishness. We human beings, we've learned so much that we now know that every living thing on earth evolved over billions of years from one tiny organism that somehow came to life all on its own on a planet that formed itself over billions of years. Isn't that brilliant? Right? We are wise. What does God say? That's foolishness. Right? Human beings in America, we're progressing so far that we now know that marriage is just an old repressive tradition. I mean, do you realize that it's so much better for people not to have to commit to anybody? Right? Just free sex with whoever you want to. And I mean, let's be honest, kids, they don't need a mother and father. Families are so last century, right? We're wise. What does God say? It's foolishness. Has not God made foolish the wisdom of this world? Can you see that there's this irreconcilable difference between human wisdom and God's wisdom? And here's maybe the greatest example. It's going to sound simple, but this is maybe the greatest example of the difference between our wisdom and God's wisdom. What we human beings like to say is, it doesn't matter what you believe. Just be good. Just be kind. Just be tolerant. That's all that life is about. You hear that all the time, right? It sounds so simple. Just what is that saying? All that life is about is you and me being kind, being good. In other words, whom do we not need? God. What don't we need to think about? Forgiveness. Because, I mean, sins, what sins? We're good, right? We're kind, we're wise. What does God say? He says that's foolishness. God has a different plan. Paul writes, for since in the wisdom of God, the world through its wisdom did not know him, God was pleased through the foolishness of what was preached to save those who believe. I want you to listen to that last part again. God was pleased through the foolishness of what was preached to save those who believe. Jesus once said a prayer during his life. He said a prayer to God the Father. He said, I praise you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, for you have hidden these things from the wise and learned and revealed them to little children. Matthew 11, verse 25. See, God was pleased to save people not through our wisdom, but through, like a little child, believing in the message of Jesus and share it with us. God was pleased through the foolishness of what was preached to save those who believe. So we should ask, well, what's that foolishness? What's the foolish message of God that's preached? Maybe the best summary in the Bible is this. All have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, and all are justified freely by His grace through the redemption that came by Christ Jesus. Romans 3, 23 and 24. This is the foolish message of God. You and I, all people, we are sinful and we cannot save ourselves. And so Jesus Christ came into our world and He died on the cross to take away all of our sins. And it's those who believe in Jesus who have forgiveness and eternal life. And the message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing. But to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. This is the problem. The problem is we always want something more. We always want something more than just a cross. Paul writes that the Jews demand signs, and the Greeks look for wisdom. The Jews and Jesus say, we're always demanding from Jesus signs. Right? There was something you were going to remember for the sermon. Do you remember what it was that you were going to remember? In our gospel lesson, Jesus clears out the temple, and what do the Jews ask him? What's the sign that you're going to do? They were always asking for signs. Has that changed? How often do you or I look up to God and say, God, show me a sign? In our city, Oral Roberts built his whole ministry about miraculous signs. Right? This was the message, the cross. It's not enough. Look at all of these signs. This is what it's all about. On the other hand, Paul says that the Greeks were looking for wisdom. You don't have to be a history scholar. I bet you know some ancient philosophers from Greece. Can you think of some famous philosophers? I bet you've heard of some. Socrates, Plato, Aristotle. Heard of any of those guys? They're all from Greece. Greece was known for its wisdom. There was a Greek historian who said, on the streets of any city in Greece, you can find so-called wise men who have solutions to all of the world's problems. Does that sound familiar? And on every talk show, on every blog, you will find wise men and women who have the solutions to all of the world's problems. And then you look at the Bible's message and you say, that doesn't make sense. We should cut those parts out, like Thomas Jefferson did. That's foolish. But listen to Paul's response. The Jews demand signs. The Greeks look for wisdom. But we preach Christ crucified. What is at the heart of Christianity? It's Christ crucified. In the next chapter of 1 Corinthians, Paul says, when I came to you, I resolved to know nothing except Jesus Christ and Him crucified. Part of Christianity is that Jesus died on the cross for the sins of the world. And we can admit that seems kind of upside down. It's not what heroes do. It's not what the Paw Patrol does. And yet it's a beautiful message. Because through His death on the cross, Jesus forgave all of your sins. Jesus proved God's gracious love to you. See, the message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. You hear lots of different Christian messages, don't you? You see lots of different Christian churches, and maybe this is one way to test whether that church is really teaching the message of the Bible. It's to ask this, are they focused on signs and wisdom? If so, stay away. Are they preaching Christ crucified? That's what it's all about. We preach Christ crucified. Paul goes on to say Christ crucified it's a stumbling block to the Jews and foolishness to the Gentiles. And we have to be ready to see this, that even the cross of Christ can be a stumbling block that pushes people away from God. Paul says the cross is a stumbling block to Jews. The Jews in Jesus' day were looking for a powerful Messiah who would set them free from the Romans and make Israel great again. And so when they saw Jesus die on a cross, what did they think? That's it. No thanks. It seems like a lot of Christians in America are looking for a powerful Savior who will destroy our enemies and make Christians important again. Watch out. Because when you look at the cross of Jesus, then what are you going to see? That's it? No thanks. Christ crucified was a stumbling block to the Jews and foolishness to the Gentiles. The Apostle Paul once had the chance to preach to the wisest people in Greece. He was in the city of Athens. And they let him stand up and preach to the Areopagus, the wise people of Athens, and it went pretty well until Paul said one thing. They were listening until he said one thing, and then they stopped him. Do you know what he said that made them stop him? Jesus rose from the dead. The moment he said that Jesus rose from the dead, they began to sneer at him. This is in Acts chapter 17. Somebody rising from the dead? It's foolishness. There's a way we talk about that in the United States, a really cool way. You know what it is? It's YOLO. You know what YOLO means, right? You only live once. YOLO. Right? You're not that cool, I guess, huh? What is that saying? You only live once. What's that saying? This life is all there is. Right? Just live it up now. Doesn't matter what you do. Live however you want to do because there's nothing more. Right? There's no resurrection. There's no eternal life. Come on, it's foolish. YOLO, you only live once. Here's what Paul says. We preach Christ crucified, a stumbling block to the Jews, foolishness to the Gentiles, but to those whom God has called, both Jews and Gentiles, Christ, the power of God and the wisdom of God. What Paul wants you to know is that Jesus is everything that everyone is looking for. Jesus is the power of God. If someone is looking for signs and miracles, Jesus did all sorts of signs and miracles in his ministry. He turned water into wine. He calmed storms on the Sea of Galilee. He fed 5,000 people. He raised himself back from the dead. Jesus is the power of God. If you're looking for wisdom, wow, listen to what Jesus preached during his ministry. He taught about loving our neighbor. Taught about putting God first. He taught about living with love and humility to those whom God has called. Christ is the power of God. Christ is the wisdom of God. Jesus is everything that everyone is looking for. Because you see, the foolishness of God is wiser than human wisdom. And the weakness of God is stronger than human strength. If you're going to follow Jesus, get used to saying this: I'm a fool. If being a fool means believing in Jesus, I'm a fool. If being a fool means worshiping a God who died on a cross, I'm a fool. If being a fool means confessing that I'm sinful and I can't save myself, I'm a fool. If being a fool means clinging to the cross of Jesus, I'm a fool. See, the message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. Jesus loves you. Jesus forgives you. How can you be sure? The cross. We preach Christ crucified. Never be ashamed of the foolishness of the cross. Amen. Let's say a prayer. Dear Lord Jesus, we have to admit that when we really think about the message of your word, to our human thinking, it sounds foolish. It sounds foolish to think that we can't just be good enough on our own. It sounds foolish to think that you, God, became a man and died for us. It sounds foolish to think that at the center of our faith is a cross. And yet your wisdom is not the same as our wisdom. You chose to save us in a way that would point to us not to wisdom but to faith. To faith in you and what you've done for us. Dear Jesus, help us never to be too wise to believe in you. Help us never to get so intelligent that we think that we don't need a Savior. Keep us like those little children you mentioned in the Bible. Keep us as humble believers in you. The world calls us fools, then maybe we fools for you. Help us never to be ashamed of the foolishness of your cross. In your name we pray. Amen. See, by confessing our faith in God with the words of the Nicene Creed. Please stand as we confess our faith together. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became fully human. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended to heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who in unity with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Christian apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
May be seated.
Another thing that looks foolish that Christians do is to give our offerings to God. God gives us this promise that when we give to him, we don't actually have less. We actually have more. He encourages us to give out of the willingness of our hearts and to thank him for his generosity to us. You can put your offering in the box in the back, or you can give online. Thank you for your generous gifts to our church. We have a number of people that keep in our prayers today. So we go to our God with our prayer of the church. Dear Heavenly Father, we know that you love us, and the proof of that is the cross of Jesus. You didn't spare your own Son, but you gave him up for us all. We know that along with Jesus, you'll give us everything we need for life. A number of people that we want to keep in our prayers today, we pray for the uncle of Aaron Doohan. Aaron's uncle, Russ, had a heart attack and is in intensive care. Lord, it sounds like this man needs a major open heart surgery to try to fix the problems in his heart. Lord, we place him into your care. Give doctors and nurses wisdom. Bless the surgeons who carry out this procedure. If it's your will, we ask that you spare his life in this difficulty. Give him faith in you and your promises for this life and for the life to come. We say a prayer of thanks on behalf of Lydia Johnson's husband, Eric. Eric had successful knee surgery this past week. We're thankful that you give doctors the wisdom to do procedures like this, which make our lives better. Thank you for blessing Eric's surgery in these difficult days of pain and recovery. Give him patience. Help him and Lydia to trust in you and your plan for their life. We pray for a friend of our member, Hannah Doohan. Hannah's friend and prior teammate lost her mother yesterday to cancer. The mother's name was Leslie Paulson. Lord, we pray for Leslie's family. His cancer was a surprise. It came quick and took her life quick. We ask that you be with Leslie's family. Give them comfort in your promises. Help them to know that this doesn't change your love for them. Help them to trust in your promise of life together in heaven. Finally, we pray for all those that are impacted by the wildfires in Texas and western Oklahoma. Lord, it sounds like many people's lives have been devastated. In difficulties and tragedies, you call on us to call on you. Help the people there to find strength in your promises, to call on you for help, and Lord, in your time, may you deliver them. We ask this in the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours,
now and forever.
One wonderful blessing that connects us with Jesus' cross is the Lord's Supper, in which we give Jesus' body and blood for the forgiveness of our sins. When the Bible talks about the Lord's Supper, it says it's very important for someone to have studied the Bible and to believe what the Lord's Supper is before they receive it. That's why at our church we ask that visitors who aren't a part of our church would not take the Lord's Supper with us until you've had the chance to study God's Word together with me. I'm excited because right now I have 3 different faith builders classes going with different people who want to join our church. And if you'd like to study God's Word with me, please reach out to me and I'll set up a time to start meeting with you too. Continue on page 12. Please stand. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts. Give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give Him thanks and praise.
Praise to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In love He has blessed us with every spiritual blessing. Now have come the salvation and the power and the kingdom of God and the authority of Christ. To Him who sits on the throne and to the Lamb be praise and thanks and honor and glory forever and ever.
Saying, take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me.
He took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it to them, saying, drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Thank you.
And go today with God's blessing. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make His face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look on you with favor and give you peace.
Amen.
Close by singing one more song about Jesus' cross. I think it might be a new song to some of us. It's a beautiful song, though, the power of the cross.